But they usually reappear sometime later in the evening down on Hollywood Boulevard next to a bag lady.
What'd she look like?
You don't want to know. Anyway, now we understand each other, I think we can probably get on with the show. The gentleman who's performing here for you tonight, he has sort of the rare distinction of having performed in every room here at the castle. No. Usually I work alone. Good. Well, he has performed in all the showrooms here at the castle, which is kind of unusual because we usually feature different kinds of magic in all the showrooms, which sort of shows him to be a very well-rounded performer. We're always glad to have him back here, and I think he's going to have a lot of fun. So, would you please help me give a real warm welcome to your artist, Earl Oliver.
Before I get started here this evening, I want to clear up a little misconception which has been handed down through the ages about magicians, and it concerns magicians' honesty. And so I want to tell you the truth now so that you'll know the way it really is. Magicians are thoroughly reprehensible people. And if you have any sense at all, you won't trust me any further than you can throw me. Having said all that, I wonder if there's someone out here who could loan me $100 bill.
Yeah, Lynn, that lady over there.
Anybody at all, I don't care how dirty your money is. There's a gentleman reaching in my
phone.
Oh, great.
They always find a show off in the magic.
All right.
One every minute.
You don't have any lines here. Now, what I'm going to show you here is not a magic trick. As a matter of fact, it's an educational lesson. Good night, everybody. No, actually, this is an education lesson. I'm going to show you how you can tell real money from fake or counterfeit money. Now, this could really come in handy. One of these days, somebody might try to pass off a counterfeit bill on you. If you know the secret, you can never be fooled. And this is what you do. You look for the little silk threads. Now, let me explain that. Here in the United States, we print money on what's called rag paper. That's paper that has little silk threads running through it. It makes it very durable. Also makes it very hard to counterfeit. Probably the reason why they do it. Anyway, if you ever think you've been handed a counterfeit bill and you want to be sure, just look for the silk threads, and this is the way you do it. Take your bill, you roll it up into a little paper cone, just like that. Now this kind of concentrates all that silk I was telling you about. If you reach inside, you get a hold of the corner, and you pull the whole thing out in one piece. It's really true. Just reach in there, and hold it. Just pull the whole thing out. You know, applause makes some magicians nervous. That's all I'm talking about. Guy can only stand so much stunned silence. All right, well, doubtless many of you are thinking to yourselves at this moment, how in the world does the government manage to hide something this large and this brightly colored inside of something as small as an ordinary $100 bill? Well, I'll show you how to do that. Down at the Mint, they've got a little machine, and what this machine does is it rolls these bills up into little paper cones, just like that. Now, they take their silk threads, which I've conveniently gathered into a little handkerchief here, and they place them inside the bill. Now, I'm going to show this to the folks down in front here, and they will verify for the people in the cheap seats that the silk threads are really going inside that bill, are they not? I mean, they're not going up my sleeve, for instance. They're not going a little hole in my hand or anything like that. You know, I wouldn't try to fool you. I might try to fool you. Anyway, if I place that all the way inside of there, and push it way down in there and give it kind of a fusing motion. This is very important. You see, this fuses that silk back inside the bill. And that's all. Oh. Where was that fella? Okay, well, thank you. So here's your five back. No, I don't think. Oh, yeah, I do. Afraid they didn't bring my bench out here. I want to introduce my very special guest to you in just a moment, but before I do that, I'd like to introduce my lovely assistants. What's your name?
Marcia.
Marcia? And your name?
Melissa.
Marcia and Melissa.
Ooh.
Oh, I like that. That sounds like a dance team. Well, I'm going going to introduce you now to my very special guest this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, the world famous train coin. No, you know, actually, I don't know that they're world famous, but they insist on being billed that way. But they are trained. Now, for instance, they're trained to do acrobatics. If you think about it, this is the only way a coin can get around. Sometimes I can get them to work as a duet. And if I'm really lucky, I may be able to make a quartet out of them. Now, a lot of magicians use train coins, but they don't usually admit it. Now, they would have you believe they do their miracles through skill alone, when actually it's the coins who do all the work. That's really true. I'll show you. This is a typical train coin stunt, something that magicians generally try to pass off as some sort of sleight of hand. But actually, this is train coins, and I like to call this thumb bridge. That's sort of like umbrage, but it's different. Anyway, take your four coins, and you make a thumb bridge. This is a thumb bridge. You know what happens when you make a thumb bridge? Yeah, you gotta figure it out. One of those coins gets up and it walks across the other side. That's the worst. Now, I'll show it to you again. Maybe you thought you saw that, but you didn't. So I'll show it to you again. There's one. There's two. You're watching this very closely. All right, now watch. This time you'll even hear it. Now, I'm going to try this the hard way, just once. And the hard way is where you place one coin inside each hand and another coin on the outside of each hand. Now, as I said, this is the hard way. It takes a little bit of concentration, so if you just bear with me for a moment. Assure you, however, this is not sleight of hand. These are train coins. They do this all by themselves. Now, I'll prove it. This time I won't make any strange moves. Okay, I've got three in this hand, and I've got one in this hand, and I haven't done anything yet. I think I got this one. Obviously you're not watching. I've got one. I wouldn't try to fool you. So if I've got one there, then obviously I've got to have three over here. Alright. Now again, we're going to make that thumb bridge. As soon as my thumbs touch. Now, for those of you who may not be quite convinced that these are train coins, I'm going to attempt to produce basically the same effect again, only this time I won't use my hands. Now, if I don't use my hands, then it can't be sleight of hand, right? I'm going to use I'll use the cards, actually, to cover the coins. And I suppose since I only have two cards, you would think I would only use, or I only have two hands, you'd think I would use two cards. But as you can see, there's no way I can do that. See, no matter what I do here, you know, you're going to end up, some of these are going to be out in the cold, right? Unless I use all four of my cards. Now, I want you to watch this very closely, because it happens very quickly. If you blink, you're going to miss this. All right, there. All I do is just cover and snap. I'll show that to you again. Maybe you thought you saw that, but you didn't. You got another one right there. Just give it a snap. Now, this last one is the easiest one of all, because all you do is just touch this little reset button. It's right here in the center of the card. And that causes the last coin to travel through the table. It moves over a couple of inches, comes back up. And there you go. by your reaction that you found this rather surprising. However, this is not the big surprise. The big surprise is over here. So people in a glandular condition. Well, now, a very good friend of mine came up to me a few nights ago, and he said, Earl, you do wonderful things with your train coins, but you really should try and do something with sleight of hand once in a while, just so they can see the difference between the two. And I said, well, that's fine, except that I don't know any sleight of hand tricks. And he said, well, that's all right, I'll teach you one. So he taught me a trick using sleight of hand with untrained coins. These are too young to be trained. They've still got the copper band around the side. These are what you call almost silver dollars. All right. Now, I'm going to stand up and do this. It's a little easier. And what I'm going to do here is something that magicians call through the table, which will make some kind of sense after I get into the trick. Take my four sort of silver dollars, and I take the glass, and I find a soft spot on the table. Cause one of those coins to penetrate through the table. Now, I'll show that to you again. Maybe you thought you saw that, but you didn't. Three. One in the glass.
And again, we'll find that soft spot.
Now, you might be thinking there's something very complicated happening here, but let me assure you, this is not complicated. As a matter of fact, it's quite simple. It's simple as two and two. There's two right there. Two. Two in the glass. And again. Cause the third coin to penetrate through the table. Now, at this point, I know that if I keep doing this the same way, you guys are going to catch me out here. So I'm going to try and do this last one a little bit differently. Rather than take this glass under the table, I'm going to leave it right here, but I'm going to see if I can't toss this coin into the glass from over here someplace. Wait a minute. That was supposed to make a noise. Remember that noise it made when it fell in there before? Oh, I know what happened. I missed the glass. Well, I thought so. Now, actually, I have to tell you the truth. You know, I told you a while ago that I'm not too honest. These are really trained coins. See, these are just slightly trained. And, yeah, sort of. They're learning from the other guys. And they have a lot of fun. I'm going to try something with the cards here, and I don't do a whole lot of card tricks. I feel kind of clumsy with the cards, especially if I come back tonight. If you come back tonight for the late show and you see Mr. Martin Nash working the three later programs in this room, and this guy does such amazing things with cards, you wouldn't believe it. But anyway, I pursue my puny efforts here and see what I can sort of think. Alright, let's give us a couple of shuffles here. Ordinary trick deck of cards. And would you care to select a card?
Not that.
No, I'm kidding. Go ahead and take a look at it. I'd like you to place it back anywhere that suits your fancy. I'm just going to put it in your card like that. Okay. I didn't let you shove it all the way in because I wanted to let you see my card. Just there. Get that in. I'll hold it up to the mirror. Cards. Now, I'm going to try something simple to start. As I'm not all that skillful with cards. And I have a simple trick, which seems to have a good effect. And let's see. Before I start, let me give it a couple of cuts here. Now, since you've placed your card somewhere towards the center of the deck, and I've cut the deck, now that means that the card must have been displaced either towards the top or towards the bottom. And I'm going to assume for the moment that your card is somewhere near the top. And so working on that assumption, I'm going to throw out a few of the top cards here. And what I would like you to do, I'm going to give you four chances to locate your card. I'd like you to turn any four of these cards face up. And let me know if you find your card. Because then the trick is over.
Good. It's a terrible way. It'd be a terrible way to do the trick.
Oh, well, there it is.
Big deal.
All right. Using the arithmetic probabilities inherent in a deck of cards, I have a mathematical formula which will rotate your card. And the mathematical formula goes like this. You take any four cards at random. I've allowed you to select the cards. And what you do is you add enough cards to each of these to make the value, the face value, add up to 10. Now, we've already got two tens here, so we don't have to do anything with these. But like this one here, I can put 7, 8, 9, 10. 8, 9, 10. Okay. Now, 10 and 10 is 20, and 8 is 28, and 7 is 35. Is that right? Okay. So if I count down 35 cards from the top, I should find your card. Watch closely. My fingers never leave my hands. Oops. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34. What was the name of that card that you... I really didn't deserve that, you see, because I used a mathematical formula. Now, anybody that knew the formula could do that trick. However, if you happen to be a magician, and I just happen to be a magician, it becomes incumbent upon you to learn certain methods of card control. And I know two methods of card control, one of them being the skill or sleight of hand method, the other is the magic method. And I'll demonstrate both of these methods to you at this time. Using your card, five of hearts, this is the skill method of card control. Place your card somewhere inside the deck, near the middle. You give it a very special kind of a cut. This is where the skill comes in. Now, if I've done this correctly, I should have your card right on top. And I'm going to check just to make sure. Okay, there you go. Now, that is the skill method of card control. And the other method is the magic method. And it's slightly different. A little simpler, actually. You take the card, you place it near the center. You just give the deck a little flip like that. See, this also brings your card back up. Now, for those of you who might not have been paying attention, I will demonstrate the skill method of card control once again. The skill method of card control. You place the card near the center. You make that very special cut. That's when the skill comes in. And if you're lucky, you should have the card, the selected card, should be right on top of you. Wait, let me try it. Alright, now I should have your card right on top. There it is. That's not easy either. I'll try the magic method. Usually the magic method is. There it is. Bring your card right to the top. Would you like to see a rope trick? No, I guess not. Well, I guess I'll have to fall back on the secret move. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, this is the only place you'll see this tonight in the Magic Castle. Ladies and gentlemen, the secret move. You want to see it again? You know, it doesn't look like much. But it does amazing things. I love it when that one works. All right, well, I think you're about ready now for the piece de resistance. I spent all day learning. The piece de resistance, ladies and gentlemen, the famous French fruit trick. So called because it is performed with famous French fruit. Plural of fruit, you know, one fruit. No, actually, seriously, the reason I call it the famous French fruit trick is because of what it says here on the container. See, it says, les oranges. That's French for the oranges. The famous French fruit trick. Famous French fruit trick. Now I'm going to start out with the preliminaries to the famous French fruit trick. And I call this counting to 10 in orange ease. I used to call it counting to 10 in lemon ease, but it was such a stupid joke. All right, counting to 10 in orange ease. And it goes like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Are you ready for this? 9, 10.
Maybe you probably thought that, but you didn't. I'll do it a little slower this time. A little slower this time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah. Possibly if I do this with 3 balls, it'll be a little more confusing. I mean, a lot of balls. Time can or orange juice. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Good.
Okay, I got it.
The famous French fruit trick, descending into the body of which, this is called the famous French fruit trick in reverse. I usually do it in reverse first, that way later on when I do it forward, you know it's reverse of what I'm doing now, which is in reverse. The famous French fruit trick in reverse, in which you place 1, 2, 3 balls in my hands. How many in my hands?
4.
Now you see, this is the famous French fruit trick in reverse. See, it's the exact opposite of the famous French fruit trick forward, which goes like this. You place 2 in your hand and 1 over here in the pocket. Now, how many have I got in my hand?
6.
That's right, because this is the famous French fruit trick forward. All right, show it to you again. See, 2 in this hand, 1 in this pocket. How many is in the hand? 3, of course, because it's the famous French fruit forward. Further ramifications of the famous French fruit trick employing an assistant. I bet you like that. Now, I'll tell you what, I need one of your palms out here.
Can I use the clean one?
No, I'm kidding. That one's fine. All right. Further ramifications of the famous French fruit trick employing an assistant. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take a couple of these for myself. I'm going to give you one to hold. Hold it real tight. Okay, turn your hand over. Now, I'm going to try to take that away from you, but I don't want you to let me do that. Are you with someone? Can we get rid of it?
Alright, make
him
disappear.
Are you trying to do that? Okay. Snapping my fingers, the ball in your hand will rise into the air. It'll circle the table 3 times. It'll come down, it'll land in my hand with a thud. With a thud, mind you. Are you ready for this? You believe it. That's what I'm saying. Here we go. See it go. I actually didn't go that time. See, I thought I'd see if she'd lie for me. If she'd lie for me, I wouldn't have to do the trick. She's not going to lie for me, so I'll have to do the trick. All right. Counting, I'm gonna snap my fingers. The ball will rise into the air, circle the table 3 times, emitting sparks. It'll come down and land in my hand with a thud. With a thud, mind you. Here we go. Did you hear it go? I didn't see it go myself, but I felt something happen. And I'll tell you, I it didn't feel right, but I'll tell you what happened. These guys have a mind of their own. Sometimes they work out their own routine. And I think that's what's happened. In fact, I'm pretty sure that's what's happened. What have you got over here?
I probably got 4.
Well, it wasn't quite the way I expected, but it did work out. All right. And now the part, ladies and gentlemen, the part of the show you've all been anxiously waiting for. The end of the famous French fruit trick. Or as they say in Paris, the famous French fruit trick, et fini. And here it is, the end of the famous French fruit trick. I'm going to place... What am I going to do? I'm going to place 2 of these in my hand and 1 in my pocket. Now, how many have I got in my hand? Now, you see, this is the end of the game. You know what? The great thing about the end of this trick is when you get down to the end, you pull out the can and you open it up and you're all set to start all over. That's not only the end of the trick, it's also the end of my act. So thank you. If you go upstairs, you can see a great show in the palace, and there's 2 great shows in the parlor. And I was serious, come back and see that fellow Martin Nash here in the close-up gallery, because he'll blow your mind. Anyway, tell them all that Earl sent you. Have a good time.
What is this?